عثمان اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي وبعد. We're going to begin today's hadith, hadith reading with, by repeating the four hadith that the Shaykh read yesterday and explained yesterday. And inshallah the Shaykh will continue by explaining some, or just repeating or explaining additional points. The reading from At-Targhib wa-Targhib, encouragement and warning, a hadith that encourage good acts and warn against bad acts. In hadith number one, Sayyidina Mu'adh ibn Jabir al-Ban said, when he was sent to Yemen, O Messenger of Allah, advise me. He said, be sincere in your religion, then little actions will suffice you. Al-Hakim narrated it from the path of Ubaidullah ibn Zahab, from Ibn Abi Amran. He said, the chain is sound. Hadith 2. Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu said, we returned from the battle of Tabuk with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, there are people left behind in Medina who whenever we move through a valley or a ravine are with us, with an excuse having detained them. Al-Bukhari and Abu Dawud narrated it, and his wording is that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, you have left in Medina people who whenever you move anywhere, spend anything or cut through a valley are with you. They said, O Messenger of Allah, how are they with us? Whilst they are in Medina, he said, sickness detained them. Hadith 3. Ubayy ibn Ka'b radiallahu anhu said, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, give God tidings to this community of praise, religion, elevation, and authority on the earth. But whoever of them does act of the next world for this world will have no portion of the next world. Ahmed ibn Hibban, in his authentic collection, Al-Hakim al-Bayhaqi recorded it. Al-Hakim said, the chain is sound. The narration of al-Bayhaqi mentions, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, give glad tidings to this community of ease, praise, elevation by religion, authority in lands and victory. But whoever of them does act of the next world for this world will have no portion of the next world. Hadith 4. Abu Ali, a man from Banu Kahil, said Abu Musa al-Ash'ari Rudman delivered the sermon saying, O people, beware of this idolatry because it is more hidden than an ant crawling. Abdullah ibn Hazan and Qais ibn Mudarib stood up and said, by Allah, you will retract what you have said, or we will go to Umar with or without permission. He said, in fact, I retract what I said. The Messenger of Allah delivered this sermon one day saying, O people, beware of this idolatry because it is more hidden than an ant crawling. Someone whom Allah had willed to speak said to him, and how can we beware of it when it is more hidden than an ant crawling, O Messenger of Allah? He said, say, O Allah, we take refuge with you from committing idolatry knowingly, and we ask your forgiveness for that which we do not know. Ahmed and Al-Tabarani recorded it. Its narrators up to Abu Ali are used in sound collections, whilst Ibn Hibban considered Abu Ali reliable, and I have not seen anyone criticize him. Abu Ya'la narrates a similar tradition, a similar narration from the tradition of Hudhayfa, accepting it. He says it three times every day.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيدنا محمد الصادق الأمين المبعوث رحمة للعالمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم لا سهل إلا ما جعلته سهلا، وأنت تجعل الحزن إذا شئت سهلا. اللهم فعل بما علمتنا وعلمنا ما ينفعنا، زدنا علما وفقينا إذا علمتنا. These are the four hadith that we mentioned yesterday. You did not have the hand out, you know. Now we have the hand out. If there's any question about any of these hadiths or a point to be clarified, let's have it done, you know, before moving to another setting, you know, of hadith. Anyone has any question about these hadiths or to clarify a point or certain comment or whatever, or shall we move on? Yes?
Maybe could you explain the last hadith again? Like, explain. Okay.
Here the Prophet ﷺ said about shirk that it's too hidden, you know, and most probably means by hidden that we are going to feel, we are going to think, many occasions we may practice something which goes against our belief or against our understanding. For example, I apply for a job, you know, and I feel that this is the whole career of me. If it happens, if I'm lucky enough, you know, to get it, you know, that means I'm going to be secured, you know, for all matters of my life, you know. Otherwise, no, you know. And this is going to occupy my mind all the time, keep thinking about it, you know. This completely goes against when we say, وَمَا تَشَاءُونَ إِلَّا أَنْ يَشَاءَ اللَّهُ. No will is going to take place with that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّ اللَّهَ بَالِغُ أَمْرِهِ. And the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who is going to have the effectiveness, you know, and to take place, you know. And other thing, you know, it's not as such, you know. So that's why even the believers, in their thoughts, in their mind, in their practice, in their attitude, in many occasions they may have it done in a way goes against their thoughts. In my view, I may be wrong, you know, the materialism, you know, is the major factor in this regard, you know. When the Muslims, they became materialistic, you know, they are going really to be preoccupied, you know, by this materialism a lot. And I came across many of those actions, many of those behavior, many of those statements, which is not applicable, you know, this doesn't work, you know, in our Islam. So here the Prophet ﷺ warned us of something hidden inside ourselves, you know. This is apparently part of the nature, okay. We have the nafs need, which always keep nagging on us, you know. And this is perhaps, in one way or another, it's important for our survival. You know? When it go beyond its limits, you know, it became too harmful, okay? The essential of it, it's too important, you know, to survive, you know, in this life. To feel that you are hungry and you should go and eat. You feel thirsty and you go and drink or whatever. You know? But when it go beyond its needed limit, you know, when it try to take over some of the matters of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it became like a hidden hypocrisy or whatever of that regard or idealism or whatever. And by this, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam warned us why? Because we should always keep our statements, our thoughts, you know, in our mind. We should always rebook ourselves, you know, about those matters, you know, حَاسِبُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ قَبْلَ أَن تُحَاسِبُوا. Okay, here it's too hidden to the extent that even the surrounding of you, they may not know it, but you know it very well about yourself, you know. And that's why you should keep up with yourself, you should follow yourself, you know. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, be Abi Wa'um, he gave us this dua, you know, to try to practice it, you know, in the morning and the evening, you know, to repeat it, you know, frequently, three times at least, you know, morning and evening. And this is, I think should be applicable and should be done for all of us. Allahumma inna a'udhu an ushrika bika shay'an wa ana a'lamu wa astaghfiruka lima la a'lam. Okay, you made it, make it, you know. By this, you know, really, I try to match all of those ahadiths with the verse of the Quran that all of you repeat it at least 17 times a day. إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينُ. Okay, يعني in all aspects of your religion, without any exception, even when you drink, when you eat, when you speak with someone, when you try to any activity at all, you know, without any exception, you should have the two components. What are the two components? The first component, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ, يعني from your side, you should show your effort, how you are going to do it, observing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this matter, even in eating, drinking, and you name it. And in the meanwhile, you should combine it with seeking help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because nothing is going to happen without the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? And I see it as a great lesson, you know, to us, you know, to have, yani always I say to myself, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينُ. I'm obliged to say it, you know, 17 times or more a day, you know, at least. This is the minimum number of it, you know. And by this, just to tell myself that everything, all my activities should be of these two components. And in this hadith, I see it in the same way. The Prophet ﷺ warned us of a problem. This problem
I think, I'm not sure, I think it show up in everyone, okay, in different modality, in different way, okay, but it's shown up, you know, in everyone that some of his ideas, some of his practice doesn't fit with his belief, okay, and he should be behind himself all the time, try to correct himself, try to work himself, try to blame himself about certain matters, you know. We should show our efforts, you know, in correcting and guiding ourselves. In the meanwhile, we seek help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How do you seek help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? By this dua that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam instructed us to do, okay? I don't know if it's convenient to say, but many people, you hear that, please make dua for me. Okay, I'm going to make that. Sometimes it sounds that person doesn't want to do anything, even not making dua. He wants you to make dua for himself. So, what's your portion, my friend? What's your portion from Iyaka Na'budu, Iyaka Nasta'in? Nothing. Zero. Okay? It's a good idea to seek dua from the others. It's a good idea when you have good thoughts about certain person to be asking dua. But where is your portion? Have you done your dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to seek him wa iyyaka nasta'in? Have you done your effort, you know, to show that at least you show how eager, how effective, and all of us without any exception, okay? We are going to find in our life when we are too eager to do something, you know, we are going to show the best cleverness that we have, the best effort, you know. And when anyone stands in your way, go away, I'm busy with this, you know, and you will not show yourself as a weak person, you know, please do this or that, you know. This is perhaps not that the best attitude. You should have it combined with what's in your your heart, that nothing is going to happen without the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the greatness about your Islam, you know. You should have the combination of them, you know. And I really admire this from Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib, his answer to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him to do something, you know, and he later on asked him, are you going to do this? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, the slave of Allah means himself, you know, I'm determined, وَمَا تَوْفِيقِي إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. Okay, and here he gave the two combinations. I'm determined to do it, you know, but I'm not going to be helpful to myself without the support of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, and some of you, they heard this joke, you know, because it's written, you know, in that some books, you know, they said that a person went to buy a donkey, you know, and he met with his friend, you know, asking him, where are we going? He said, I want to buy a donkey. He said, say inshallah. He said, what's the point? Why should I say inshallah, you know? I have a lot of money in my pocket, you know, and in the market there's a lot of donkeys. And he saw him later on, you know, at the end of the night or the day or the evening, frowning, you know, and not looking good. What's going on here? He said, I was stolen, inshallah. So he used it improperly. Okay, he did not use it in its place. Okay. Even if you have money and you are smart and everything is available for you, it's not going to take place without the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And to be honest with you, this is my view. I don't know if I'm right or not. Not yet. The greatest matter you may pick up here is the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When you read the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's too great. He's our master. He's the most beloved person to Allah. But we see it as ordinary seerah of a person, you know. He did not fly all the time. He did not show miracles all the time. He used to get sick, you know. Many of his companions in certain events, they were killed, you know, by the enemies. He was hurted himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He has his tooth broken. He has laceration on his holy face, you know. He fell in one of these holes, you see. Yeah, and here, this greatness and simplicity to combine them together, I think this is a miracle, okay? And we should have the same combination, okay? Not, let's be thorough with you. I'm not telling not all of you, you are awliya. No, inshallah, all of you are awliya. But even the awliya that in your mind is not all of the same style that you imagine. We imagine awliya that they should be, they should know what's going in my mind, and they should know what I have eaten this morning, you know, or whatever, you know, of this regard. This is not necessarily the description of the awliya. You may have a much higher rank, you know, of awliya. They don't know those matters, you know, and they don't care about this matter, rather, you know, okay? Yani here, to be too simple, you know, and too great at the same time, this is the tradition of your Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Okay? Like Sayyidina Uwais al-Qarani, I feel he has very great relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But now, we don't know a lot about him. Almost hardly, you know, just few matters, you know, about him, you know. This doesn't reduce his greatness. He's still too great, you know why? Because he was praised by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He's too great person, you know. Even though we don't know about him that he walked on the ocean, you know, or fly on the sky, or did so or this or that, you know. But and this is, again, I emphasize it in a lot, you know. Here you have the two components of it. The first component to show the extraordinary in this life. And this is what people, they are interested in. And this may happen to wali or non-wali, may happen to believer or non-believer, may happen to the one who has strong connection with jinn, you know, and you name it, you know. And you have the other component of it, which is, how do you know Allah? What is your relation with Allah? How confident you are in Allah? Are you a real friend of Allah? And you name it, okay? All those matters, okay? And this is what buy, you know? This was what count. And the greatness of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I keep speaking, alhamdulillah, يعني, I'm proud of this, you know, speak about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even though I feel myself too deficient, you know, to speak about those issues, you know? But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was one of the greatest person, you know, who dealt with all of those ordinary measurements in this life. He used to get hungry, he got married, he has children. Most of his children, they passed away in his life. You see, يعني, all those matters, you know, looks like he used to have headache, you know, all the time. He used to get sick frequently, you know, and you name it, you know. And yet, when you look at his relation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what he has done with this not long age, you know, 63 years old, you are going, for sure you are going to fully respect this, you are going to fully admire this, you know. And this is a lesson to all of us, you know, to have this combination, okay, all the time, okay. And I spoke yesterday about the two sections that we have, the one who are knowledgeable, you know, and maybe have fair practice, you know, but they don't have the strong feeling in their heart, and the other side who have those strong love, you know, and feeling in their heart, but they are not good practitioners. And I think both of them, they are deficient in one way or another, you know. They are deficient in certain portion of the tradition of the Prophet. I call this the tradition of the Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Again, how great our religion, why? Because we have the theory, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, and we have the practice. Okay, and I see this hadith number 4 as very good example of it. This is for negative point, okay? And here again, the Islam is great because he speak with you about your negative point and your positive point. Here you have problem. Here you have deficiency, you know. Here you have something which is not right, not good. And it's in all of us, and all of us, we should find our way, you know, to treat ourselves. Like when I got sick, you know, I go and seek medical advice, and here in the same way, I am sick in my soul, I'm sick in my heart, I'm sick in my relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and really I'm in need to seek help, you know. From where should I get the help? The best among us to get the help from the Creator, who knows the best. أَلَا يَعْلَمُ مَنْ خَلَقَ. How do I have the ability to get this from Allah? Yes, through who? Through the Messenger of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent us this message, either in the Quran al-Kareem, the tradition of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. All, يعني, really, I'm sorry to keep repeating myself, we have a lot of treasures, you know, in our hands, you know, which bring the happiness, not only for me and you, this bring the happiness to her, not only for the humankind, to all creation. Bring the happiness to all creation, to the mountain and to the whales and the oceans, you know, and you name it, you know, to everything. You have it all in your hand. And the worst among us, those who have it, and they don't know the value of it. And what is much more worse than those people, those who use it only, يعني, this is Quran, and this is just to be used in the mosque, you know. Okay, when I get out the mosque, I close everything, and I should behave like the others, you know, and go like the others, you know. They are much worse than the first one, okay? Why? Because they make the Quran and the tradition just a tool, you know, to have little calmness, you know, or quietness, you know, inside the mosque, and that's it. They did not know that if you want to become happy in your life, to have the best marriage, the best children, the best everything, you know, in this life, when you hold yourself to this Quran, as we said before, you know, man amila salih, and whoever have good deeds, you know, of male or females, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the guarantee. And you see this form, فَلَدُحْيَنَّهُ in Arabic. It's not used except when there's a hidden oath. That means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swear here that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to grant him with a decent life. And I don't expect anyone look forward to have much more than a decent life. Okay? Because when it's described a decent life from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, يعني if I'm given that choice, put everything you want, or let Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala choose for you. Haven't you have it in your experience that in many times you are going to choose something, you know, and the opportunity is not given to you. You did not have what you have chosen, you know. Later on you find out that the choice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was much better than you chose. This is our belief, this is our understanding of this life, okay? And this is going to be in the hereafter. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us, you see, I like this, you know, excuse me.
Yeah, Habibi.
The last one to enter the heaven, you know. Before entering the heaven, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tell him, ask whatever you want to ask. But the greatness about it, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep reminding him, we have so and so, we have. Yeah, this person, what does he know? What is he going to ask, you know? It's too limited. All of us, we are too limited. Allah, out of his greatness, you know, out of his generosity, he tell that person, listen, we have this matter. We remind him about certain matter, certain issue. Take this, take that, you know. This is good for you. You see, how great is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How generous is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Okay? And then I should complete it, you know. And then when he finished, just imagine, you know, if someone, some of us given the chance, you know, to just hope and ask, you know, it's going to keep asking, you know, for 10 years, 20 years, or whatever. Whenever he finished, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going, he said, we are going to give you, and like the dunya 10 times. And this is beyond his understanding. He said, oh, yeah, my Lord, you are joking with me, having shown tahza'u bi wa anta rabbul alameen, having fun of me, you know. And you see, alhamdulillah, we have this with this picture. Don't forget this picture. يعني here you have it by your eyes and your ears. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم at this time smiled till بدت نواجذ the back of his teeth. You know they are shown. Okay. يعني here you have this statement with that this. Very, I don't know what to say about this picture. They are combined together, okay? And this, if you don't know, I haven't tasted it. I mean, we may taste it. When the Prophet ﷺ smiled, and as the companion, they said, you know, you are going to find everything surrounding, you know, smile. The walls, the ceiling, the everything is going to be different, you know. So here the Prophet ﷺ, you see the message, this is the message from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, given by the messenger, gave us this good tiding, good thought about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by voice and by picture, okay? And this is, if you take my word for it, you know, just always have this great hope, you know, in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Great raja in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Good thoughts about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as narrated by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hadith, حُسْنُ الظَّنِّ مِنْ حُسْنِ الْعِبَادَةِ. When you have good thought, glad tiding, you know, in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, good thought about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this part of your good worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, okay? You want to be good worshiper of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, besides praying and fasting and with this and that, join to this your thoughts about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, okay? Have the top, you know, the utmost, you know, thought of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This should be a tough question. You know, I'm a very small student. You are a great Sheikh.
Sheikh, you mentioned that it can be more hidden. The air can be so hidden that nobody else can see it. Is it possible that it can be so hidden that you yourself don't realize you have it? And if that is, then how are you held accountable for it?
It may be even not felt by the person, okay? General speaking, most of those matters, they are going to be felt. But we tend to give different standard, okay? And this is another problem in us, okay? I give you this example about it. If the boy of the neighbors, you know, he had some misbehavior, you know. You may feel bad, you know, in yourself. You may start to speak badly about him, you know. This is impolite boy. He has done this or that, okay? After a few months, you may have, not, I may have my boy, you know, do the same thing. We tend, you know, to give a lot of excuses. I said, even though my son has done the same, but he had headache at that day, you know, and he had a bad day in the school, and he has this and he has that, okay? And we try to create a lot of excuses to ourselves, you know, and we try to offend the others, which is the same action, or sometimes my son action may be much worse than the other, okay? Here, we tend to have the same excuses to ourselves, okay? Even though I wore three masks, you know, when I gave this lecture, you know, this is just to attract people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I make myself sound as if Allah in need of me, okay? I put those masks, which is prohibited, you know, I should show my nature. I shouldn't make any mask, you know, because this is the tradition of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. كان سره وعلانيته سواء. Okay, the major inviter to Allah is Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he, to best of honor, never ever had any mask on his face. We don't speak about physical; speak about non-physical mask. Never ever he speak about something that he doesn't believe in. Never ever he has any behavior that against what he think. You see, when he was in Mecca at the beginning, you know, in these old days, you know, from the apparent way, you know, even though we know that he has the full support from Allah, has just few people, all of them, they are punished badly by the mushrik, you know, and they were in very bad situation. And they gave him the offer. Okay? Let's have a deal, you know. We worship your God one day, you worship our gods, you know, the other day. You know, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ لَا أَعْبُدُ. يعني here, some politician will tell you, negotiate, يا أخي, make some, يعني, have some good environment, you know, and then trick them, you know, and then, okay. Then after that, يعني, which is more surprise, they offer him to make him a king on them, you know, ruler on him. And he refuses. You see, يعني here the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم quite clear, quite obvious. I came for this task, you know, I have nothing else to do, okay? You tell me you should be strong economically. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم doesn't care about this. Even spending money, he's going to spend a lot of money, you know, just because he feels that he's going to work the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants him to work. And the other task is not on him. This is the matter of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He gave me victory, that's it. Otherwise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows the best. So this is the life of the Prophet. And unfortunately, we are weak. Okay? We try to feel that this way may help us, you know. And we fool ourselves, we say, this is just for the invitation of Allah. You see, I'm really bad man, you know. But it's unfair, you know, to show my bad or wrongdoing in front of the others, you know. I should pretend like highly respected one, you know, and frown here, you know, and make everyone kiss my hand, and that's it. No, this is not the case of the Prophet, okay? He will be according to himself, okay? Exactly. And this is the way we should be at, okay? Be your nature. I'm not telling you, you know, to misbehave in front of the others or commit haram or uncover yourself, you know. But don't in the meanwhile, don't pretend of matters that you don't have. And here it's applicable when the Prophet said too hidden, I feel most of it is not going to be hidden to the person, but the person is unfair because he has two standards. He's going to scale himself by one scale and have the other standard for the other. That's why يعني, I think this is one of the major reasons why Sadatun al-Sufayl, they said you should have a sheikh, okay? يعني here, as in your health, you should have a doctor, you know, to take care of you. And the worst patient, this statement, I have heard it from many people, you know, the worst patient is one who the doctor himself. This is the worst patient will be. Why? Because he's going to have a lot of assumption and a lot of that. The other one is going to surrender, you know, completely because he doesn't have other choices. So here, it's the same thinking. To treat myself, regardless of how knowledgeable I am, how experienced I am or whatever, it's the most difficult thing. I don't say it's impossible, you know, but it's too difficult. That's why, in this case, you seek the help. The best thing to have, Sheikh, you know, is well trained. They call him very perfect Sheikh, you know, to tell you about your deficiencies, you know. If you don't have it, let's resurrect this sunnah, you know, that I mentioned yesterday. وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. Okay? يعني we lack this a lot, you know, among ourselves as Muslims, you know. يعني I don't bring so-and-so telling him, listen, you have said this word to do it today which is not good. Usually we don't do it, we don't practice it. I don't know about your community. In our communities we are really bad about this, you know. We don't advise each other. I don't know here. Why we don't, يعني I feel myself deficient in this point, you know. We should have better, yeah. يعني here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swear by time. والعصر. إن الإنسان لفي خسر. Humankind, general, they are in bankruptcy or in loss. Except the one who has the four items. What's the relation between these four items and the time? Regardless how smart I am, how well experienced I am, how educated I am, you know, you cannot gain all experience, you know, you cannot gain all knowledge or you name it. That's why when you ask so and so, seek advice from this person and the other one, you are going to collect a lot of experiences, you know, a lot of knowledge. Some of them you know, many of them you don't know, and you have it all for yourself, okay? That's why even the righteous one is going to be bankrupted. Why? Because in his limited age, he cannot expose himself to all of this experience, you know? And whenever he has any of those questions, you know, when he doesn't have the definite answer, either he should have a sheikh, you know, or to seek advice from his friends, you know? And nothing wrong with this, you know. When a knowledgeable person asks a person like me, not knowledgeable, you know, this doesn't mean that I'm superior to him or I know much better than him. No, I'm going to give him different view that he doesn't know. Okay? All of us, we are limited to all aspects of our life. We are going to have a view. Some of us, we have very too narrow one. The other may have broader one, but for sure, all of us, we don't look it from outside. I cannot get rid of myself and look to myself from outside. I should seek your help. You are outside, you look at me. I cannot get outside myself and look, okay? And that's why the Prophet ﷺ gave the example that the believer is a mirror of the believer, you see? Like the mirror, here in the mirror you may see yourself, you know, as if you got outside yourself and observing the deficiencies, you know. And we are all of us, we are very good at it, you know, when we are about to leave the house, you know, just to correct my cap and to take depth, you know, of my face, and if there's something need to be washed, and if you have some hair to cut it, and you name it, we are very, perhaps, يعني never in the past, you don't have any humankind, you know, in the past, you know, they have the way we have nowadays, you know, in fixing ourselves, you know, from outside. For what? For this body that is going to vanish eventually, okay? Regardless of how good of taking care of its health and shape and whatever, it's going to vanish, okay? You have the other component. What is it? Your soul. Are we that good, you know, in taking care of the soul? Perhaps we are the worst, you know. The people, I give example, Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab. I look at him as a perfect person. He used to say, رحم الله امرأً أهدى إلي عيوبي. He make dua that the mercy of Allah come down to the one who give me as a gift my deficiencies, to tell me about my deficiencies. So if this is the case, we say, Na'am, what should I say? What should I say? See, here is the point. And that's why, yani, here, thank you for the question. Sorry, this was a very long answer. I would like to match this, you know, when the Prophet ﷺ said, listen, the shirk is too hidden, you know, in you. I would like to match it with the description, Harisun alaykum, okay. That he cares a lot about you, okay? And I would like to taste this hadith from the care of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I would like to match it. This make me understand the verse in the Quran much more and make me understand this hadith much more. Is this a written question? Where is the one? Shall we answer if there's anything? Okay, inshallah, we'll carry on. 61. وعن أبي سعيد الخدري رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من أكل طيبا وعمل في سنة وأمن الناس بوائقه دخل الجنة. قالوا يا رسول الله إن هذا في أمتك اليوم كثير. قال وسيكون في قوم بعدي.
Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anhu said, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever eats pure, acts by his sunnah, and people are safe from his harm will enter paradise. They said, O Messenger of Allah, this is widespread in your community today. He said, it will be in the people after me.
Firstly, I choose this hadith because this reminds me of Jawami' al-Kalim. Okay? يعني here, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam make it too brief, you know, in a summary, how يعني all of us, we feel ourselves stuck now, you know? We are created in this world. We have a lot of fitna around us. We see how other Muslims, they are astray, or sometimes imprisoned, or considered criminal, or this or that. How some people, they put the Muslim down. We feel fearful, you know, of, am I going to make it or not, okay? I would like to have good news, okay? And here, really I enjoy it, you know, and I would like everyone to enjoy it because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam summarized it in three components only, and he gave us the good news when he said, when they said that it's available nowadays in many, plenty of people, he said, again, it's going to be available in plenty of people later on, okay? This gives us the hope, okay? And here, give us the hope by two components. Firstly, if we want to act, how to have the instruction in very summarized way from him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then to have the good news that even among ourselves, you know, after 1400 years or more, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, many of us, they are going to be able to do it. Okay. So here, when I hear this, what should I do? I think I should be excellent in the both components. The first component of practice, and the second component of good thought of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to accept. Why? Because I have heard this statement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. How lucky we are, you know, to hear this statement from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Do you think that all Muslims, they heard this? No. You are too lucky, you know, to hear it. And this is the first step in your happiness. Okay? This is the first step. You hear it. Okay. What's the second step? Try to understand it. Third step? Apply it to your life. Fourth step, have good thought in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And inshallah, the fifth step is not from your side. You are going to be sent, you know, a message that you have been accepted. Okay. You should be determined about it, okay? You don't have any other choice. You are Muslim, okay? Are you going to give up? No, I'm not going to give up. I am Muslim. I'm going to love and live as Muslim. I'm going to die as Muslim. I'm going to be thereafter as Muslim. Okay, you are determined? Yes. Okay. Here, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave you the instruction. Okay. Let's see ourselves. Is it possible? All they are possible and easy. Unfortunately, I'm telling you, we are going to see our deficiencies in certain aspects here. We are not that good practitioner about them. But when you look at the value of them, the result of them, I'm telling you, you should sacrifice. You should give up some of what you feel is important for you or essential for you or you cannot live without, you know. You should give up of it for this price that you are going to get, you know. Okay? This price is an eternal reward for you. Okay, what you expect, you know, from this matter that you sacrifice portion of your religion for it, you know, is going to stay, if it stayed, you know, is going to stay with you with very few years, or I would rather say few days, because this is your feeling is going to be in the hereafter, as mentioned in the Quran, when they start to speak with each other in the hereafter, we only lived for 10 days. The other one said, no, I swear by Allah, we only live for one day. And they are not liars. Why? Because this is their feeling. That's what they felt about the whole life. So you see it, you know. Does it worth it, you know, for one day or 10 days, you know, to suffer a lot, you know? I would rather say, no, you are not happy here. You have something stinging, you know, in your heart all the time that you have done something wrong, okay? So why to have this pain, you know, this suffering in your heart all the time? No, take it away. Go the way the Prophet wants you to take. You may face some problem. I'm not telling you it's too easy. You may face some problem. You may, but when you experience it again and again, you are going to have very decent life, okay? And just see the feeling, you know. The Prophet, some of us may feel this impossible. It's not impossible at all. All of us, we dream. And in our dream, let's take it by this simple way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, lahumul bushra. They have the glad tidings, okay? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the glad tidings, the bushra is the dream. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to send you a message from your dream. The one who received a message from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he has been accepted, he has done well or whatever. I don't imagine that he needs anything in this life, you know. When he has his master, you know, accepted him, that's it. He doesn't care about anyone else. إِذَا صَحَّ مِنْكَ الْوُدُّ فَالْكُلُّ هَيِّنُونَ. If my love to you or your love to me has been fixed well, everything else is easy. And that's what the woman said, you know, when she saw the Prophet ﷺ after the massive killing of four of her family members. She said, كُلُّ مُصِيبَةٍ. Any disaster, you know, if you are saying this, trivial. Again, I'm telling you, I haven't tasted this yet, but this woman has tasted something. We should taste it, okay? And there's something we haven't experienced. I feel too sorry, you know, about myself that I did not. We should experience it. Okay. And when I was giving Sira, you know, back in Damascus, and we brought this story of Sayyidina Sa'd ibn al-Rabi'. Sa'd ibn al-Rabi'. Noble man, has very young daughters. And he was asked to go to Uhud, and he went to Uhud. And he was wounded badly. And the Prophet ﷺ himself, you see, I don't know how to explain this. The Prophet ﷺ himself, he said, who is going to look for Sa'd ibn al-Rabi'? And a person said, I am Ya Rasulullah. And he went shouting, Sa'd ibn al-Rabi'a, Sa'd ibn al-Rabi'a. Sa'd ibn al-Rabi'a was at the last moment, you know, of his life. They don't care, I don't care about you, about him. And he said, Rasulullah looking for you. I'm here. All of a sudden changed all the and first he starts shouting, Sa'd ibn al-Rabi'a. He doesn't care, you know, he doesn't want to answer. He said, Rasulullah looking for, I'm here. You know, it's very weak voice, you know, and very weak movement, I'm here. And he came. And here, something there, you know, I did not taste. I asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to taste it. And a patient, you know, or someone wounded badly and about to die. That's what I think, you know. Everything is going to be taken away from his mind, from his heart, except what is the most important fact in his heart. He said, listen, you tell Rasulullah, Sa'd ibn al-Rabi', tell them, Jazakallahu anna khayra. I ask myself, what did he see? What did he feel? Why did he say so? He's badly wounded, you know, killed, you know, because of that man for Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yet, before death, he said, Jazakallahu anna khayra. That means there's something there. He has something that I don't know. Something that I did not taste, you know. Really, I'm telling you, I feel jealous of this, you know. Okay? That's why when Sheikh Nasser, you know, when we read Burkhida, I say Gharu. Gharu, that means be jealous. Yani, be jealous. Yani, we read about those great person, you know, and we should be jealous, you know. That, so they are human, we are human. They are much greater than us, you know. But we would like, you know, to twist. I give you another. Sorry, I don't know. Should I keep speaking? I give the other example of it. The Prophet said, Al Quran ma'dubatullah. The invitation of Allah is Al Quran. I ask everyone, you know. You were told that there's invitation, you know, this very dear person, your brother, you know, or your father has very large invitation, you know, all type of nice food in this invitation, okay? And you are not invited. How do you feel about it?
Depends if you're there. Depends if you're there.
On the table to be eaten? Okay. Imagine if you are invited and said, listen, you are welcome, you know, but we stand at the corner. You don't have the right to come and have even a glass of water.
Who are they to decide?
Allah.
Allah. If Allah decides for me, he says, I would say, alhamdulillah. Or maybe Allah on request.
Listen, man. If you thought that only you may try the salad, you know, only, how do you feel about it? So here, I'm telling everyone in this hall, okay? Quran is the invitation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I don't expect any one of you to have dearer to his heart than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, so this is the invitation from the dearest. Okay, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as our crazy brother said, he put everything available for you. Okay, but you tend to say, no, my doctor told me I'm going only to drink a glass of water. No, I want to eat everything to this. Okay? And I want to eat everything to this. You know why? Because this is the table of Allah. This is the invitation of Allah. Okay? Again, anyone can say that he doesn't have the Quran available? All of us, we have the Quran available with us. How is our relation to the Quran? Your relation to the Quran is similar to the example of the invitation that I gave. Okay? In another hadith, the Prophet ﷺ gave example about Quran like a rope, one end by the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the other end by your hand. See how you handle this, you know, the rope that you have the other, how noble you are, you know, when you hold something, the other end in the hand of the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, so here, I feel myself smart, I feel myself religious, I feel myself this or that. Here you have certain standard, you have certain matters, you know, you should expose yourself to it, okay? Sayyidina Abu Muslim al-Khawlani, he's buried in Daraya, he's our neighbor, you know, back in Damascus. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give relief and faraj. Abu Muslim al-Khawlani, he challenged a liar prophet, Mr. Aswad al-Anasi, he used to be in Yemen, and he was liar. He declared that he's prophet. He asked a Muslim al-Khawlani, do you believe that Muhammad is messenger of Allah? He said, yes. Do you believe that I'm messenger of Allah? He said, I don't hear. Sorry, I don't hear. Repeated it again, the same answer. So he gets fed up of him, you know. He said, best way to set a large fire, you know, and throw this Abu Muslim, throw him in the fire. Okay. And that's what he did. And Abu Muslim was saved. Go back and read it in the books if you don't know your history, okay? Abu Muslim was thrown to the fire and was saved of fire. So those colleagues of the fake prophet, they told him, kick him out, you know, this is going to be fitna in your country. So he kicked him out. A Muslim said, okay, I'll go and meet with the Prophet ﷺ. He reached Medina al-Munawwara. few days after the death of the Prophet. You see how great is Abu Muslim. Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab, when he heard the story, he used to get outside Medina to, from the side of Yemen south, you know, waiting to see that person who did not burn, you know, in the fire. And he was waiting outside when Abu Muslim came. He said, from where did you come? He said, from Yemen. What's about that person who was thrown to the fire and was not burned? Oh, this is his name is Abdullah ibn Suwab. This is the name of him, okay? And said, Umar, look at him. You look as if you are that person. And he took him, you know, and he make him sit between himself and Abu Bakr al-Siddiq.
Allah.
And he said, Alhamdulillah, I thank Allah a lot that I did not pass away before seeing a person in the nation of the Prophet similar to Ibrahim. The point I want to raise, for sure Abu Muslim felt that he missed a great opportunity to see the Prophet. Okay, he missed this. What did he, yani we are going to experience perhaps the same experience, right? Or you say yes or no?
Inshallah.
No response, they are
crazy.
No, we put inshallah, you know, that's mean. I don't know, he has some doubt about it.
Inshallah, alhamdulillah.
You should say by loud voice, yes?
Yes.
We miss.
Inshallah.
Okay, so here, what's the difference? I even though you did not answer me, you know, but I feel perhaps this is your answer. I assume this is your answer. You know. I'm sorry to tell you, you know, I am a liar. You know, I'm not going to speak now a lot, and then I go to bed, you know, and sleep till morning. Shahada will wake me up for Fajr. Okay. So, but Abu Muslim, what did he do? When he missed this opportunity, what did he do? He used to spend the night praying. And whenever he feel lazy or sleepy, he has salt, what do you call salt? Whip. He used to have a whip, you know. And whenever he feels sleepy or whatever, he's going to hit his, you know, feet with this, you know, and he say, if the companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam thought that they are going to take him away and leave us, they have wrong thought. We are going to compete with them.
Allahu Akbar.
And here, that's what I would like to see. And when we feel we miss some opportunity or to try to work the way Abu Muslim al-Khawlani. And here, in the same battle, if those smart people, you know, and those shuyukh, they think they are going to get the invitation of Allah by themselves, you know, and leave us alone because we are non-Arabic speaker, or because they are not that good in teaching us, or they are completely wrong. We are not going to compete. We are going to try to read the Quran. We are going to fix our Quran regardless, okay? And we are going to compete with them, you know, on that invitation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is invitation of Allah, not invitation of anyone else. And we are going to, all of us, we are going to sit in it, you know, and have happy time. And there Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to speak with us, remind us, and we have very good time, inshallah. So here, I don't know what I said. So let's see this component, to be critics of ourselves, okay? مَنْ أَكَلَ طَيِّبًا. What we mean by طَيِّبًا here, halal. I highly appreciate the Pakistani when they look at this matter in slaughtering. This is very good, you know, way of making it halal. But this is not everything, okay? We should know where do you work, from where do you get your money, okay? And you should, whenever you have any doubt, ask the knowledgeable people, you know, about it, and see if it's halal or haram. Halal doesn't mean in the Arabic language only the slaughtered animal. No, it means anything which is legal Islamically, or we are permitted to do, okay, and anything which is illegal or wrong way of earning money is called haram. And it's similar to the non-slaughtered animal, okay? And the Prophet ﷺ in one hadith said, كُلُّ لَحْمٍ نَبَتَ مِنْ سُحِتْ. يعني when you have illegal way, you know, of feeding your children, you know, this is going to have the flesh, you know, come from illegal way, النَّارُ أَوْلَى بِهِ. It deserves to be in hellfire, this flesh. See? That's why they said, you know, in the books, whenever anyone try to get out of his house, you know, in the morning, he's going to be pulled by his wife and children, telling him, listen, we may be patient, you know, of hunger, but we are not patient of hellfire. Okay? We may tolerate to be hungry, you know, but we cannot tolerate hellfire. And that, as if they give him a lesson, you know, okay? You are responsible for us. You are going to bring food back to us. Watch this food. Is this halal, tayyib, as mentioned in this hadith, or not? Man akala tayyib. And this is the first component, okay? See from where you get your money. وَعَمِلَ فِي سُنَّةِ. As we said about the two components, when we have one component, I feel them, they are real lovers, you know, of the Prophet ﷺ, but they are not well educated, you know, to practice the tradition of the Prophet ﷺ. That's why he joined here ﷺ, the practice according to the tradition of the Prophet ﷺ. And all of us, we should be familiar of the tradition of the Prophet ﷺ. And let's consider this beginning, Jazallah khairan, Sayyidina Nuruddin, Sayyidina Harun, because the Sayyidina Tanwir also, who put this book, you know, for us, you know, let's consider it as a start. I want to have a new life, a new happy life, you know, by going by the tradition of the Prophet ﷺ. Okay? We spoke about Quran, and now we speak about the tradition of the Prophet ﷺ. And whoever joined them, he is the most guided and the most happy one, you know, in this life and in the hereafter. So this, the Prophet ﷺ put it in a condition. He is a good practitioner according to the tradition of the Prophet ﷺ. The third component, the three, they are too important. But out of my experience nowadays, I see the third one as the most major one. وَأَمِنَ النَّاسُ بَوَائِقًا. And here, we have many of us, we are good practitioners, we have good relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have a lot of good thought about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a lot. But when we look, يعني, I'm sorry to say, about our relation with each other, you know, we are really bad. Okay. When you start from the parents, to the spouses, to the children, to the neighbor, to the community, to yani, this, I'm sorry, this is my experience, you know. I worked in different countries, you know, with different nationalities, and I felt that the Muslims, they are not that good, you know, in this issue. Okay? And they don't have the expected relation, they don't know the rights of Muslims on them, you know, exactly. They are not familiar with this, even though it has been illustrated in the Quran in very summarized and thorough way, you know, in Surah Al-Hujurat. And you have Imam al-Nawawi, rahimahullah ta'ala, in Riyad al-Salihin. You have one chapter, you know, two, three pages, you know, about the Muslim right on you. Okay? Yani, you may have it all done for you, within few hours, you know, just understand those areas, you know, these texts, you know, and which came in the Quran al-Karim and the Sunnah al-Nabawi al-Mutahara. So here, the third component, even though the three of them, they are important, I see the third one is the most important in our time, according to our time. Why? Because I observe in my experience a lot of deficiency here. This is the first point. And the other, which is much more important point, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it, forgive his rights When you are sinful, commit sin to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may forgive. When you have some wrongdoing to someone else, to your father or to your wife or to your child or to your neighbor or to your friend or whatever, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive you, it's going to be unjust. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is just all the time, okay? So, why? Because this is the right of the other person. This is not the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam instructed us again, put the quote, Harisun alaykum. Okay? Harisun alaykum. Remember this. He cared a lot about you. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, اتقوا الله وأصلحوا ذات بينكم. Be fearful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and mend the problems between each other. فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ يُصْلِحُ بَيْنَ عِبَادِهِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. This is the task of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hereafter. I have problems with so and so. I did not fix it in this life. I'm going to stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the hereafter. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to fix this problem between us, you know. How shameful should I be, you know, when I look at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the majesty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala want to fix a problem, you know, between myself and a brother because I did not fix it, okay, in this life. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave an example that a person came, you know, a very worship and nice person, you know, he used to worship Allah, he has mountains, you know, of hasanat, good deeds, and all of them, they are gone away because he has treated badly his mother, he has do this to his friend, he has backbite this person, he has this, you know, lied to this person, he has deceived this person, you know, and they are going to take of his mountains, you know, and he is left without anything. And then a person come, okay, person come, he said, oh Allah, I have right on this person, you know. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, he has nothing left, what do you want to do? Nothing left, you know, no more hasana. Here, that this person say, oh Allah, I have a lot of sayyat, let him carry some of them. Again here, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam conveyed to us with picture, the tears of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam start to coming down. Okay, remember this, with the picture, you know, the holy face of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam crying. I may not understand how serious is this position, you know, but this picture from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells me that really it's too serious, you know, to have the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam crying when he starts speaking, oh Allah, let him take some of my sayyi'at. See? Let's be honest, do you have it as a problem nowadays? Why the divorce rate is too high? Why the family is distracted, you know, all over the place? Why my brother, you know, blood, I don't have good relation with him. Why is this? Why is that? Why? All those matters, you know, I may feel this is personal matter, you know, and this is concern me alone, you know, and no one has the right to interfere with this, you know. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man la yarham, la yarham." Okay, my wrongdoing, you know, is going to prohibit the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to come down, and sometimes not only on me, on the community. By what? By one wrong action from a person, you know, the whole community, they are going to miss the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So again, please, I should remind you to stay back with everyone. Remember, with the Prophet, the tears that starts coming, you know, and describing the serious position, you know. I ask myself and ask everyone, is it better to fix those matters, you know, nowadays, or to leave it to that day when you have the tears of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam coming and other hadith, you know, which I don't have the time to go, you know, with him, you know. How do you feel about, do you love Allah? Do you love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? If you really love her, you know, of those people, you know, just just fix your problem nowadays. Okay? Fix them nowadays. Okay? And if you have rights on the others, we as Sheikh Nasser told us, you know, that you should forgive everyone, you know. من نال مني أو عرفت بزمته أبرأت لله شاكرا نعمته كي لا أرى من يعقم واحدا أو من يسوء محمدا في أمته. These are poems of the Imam Shafi'i. Okay, that you see, a great Imam like Imam Shafi'i, he said, whoever had any negative or ill action toward me, he hurted me by one way or another, I'm going to forgive him, thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his Lord. Why, ya Imam Shafi'i, are you going to do so? He said, because I don't want to block any muwahid, and when say la ilaha illallah, you see, and he know the value of la ilaha illallah, or man yasu'u Muhammad, or to make Sayyidina Muhammad feel bad about his nation. Okay, see how noble is this aim, this target, you know, this not. And not to get a palace, you know, in the heaven or this or that, for this noble target. I feel such a person, he knows the real meaning of La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. We tend to speak about it, you know, but when I don't respect you, since you are holder of this same word, you know, I sound as if I don't know the exact meaning, and I don't respect this word the way it should be respected. So that's why the Prophet ﷺ, when he gave, these are three items, they are very simple. I think all of us, we have the ability to practice them, okay? Many of us, we are not practitioners in them, okay? And I see, according to my experience, that the third one is the most serious one in our life today, because we are quite deficient in it, you know? And perhaps is this the most serious one in the hereafter because of what I have explained. I remember the tears of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam this week.
The first question, is it sunnah to wear the long white dress if you're a brother? And did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wear these same clothes? Did the women wear the same long black dress as the sisters were wearing?
For the first component, we mentioned in Shama'il that the Prophet ﷺ instructed us to have the white clothes, okay, for the male people, you know. Long, the Prophet ﷺ, he used to have his soul to the mid of his legs, you know, bi-abihu wa ummi. But he said it's permitted to have it all the way to the ankles, you know. This is what's permitted, you know, for jeans. For females, in these old days, they used to have much longer clothes, you know, even. They have like fist, you know, behind them, you know, of the clothes, you know. And I think they used to have it black, you know, because Sayyidina Aisha in one hadith, she said, when the verse of hijab was revealed, you know, those women of Ansar, all of them, they start to cover themselves like the ghurban. What do ghurab you call? Like a cross, yani, this black color, you know, which means that the women, you know, in these old days, they used to have the black color, you know, in their clothes when they get out.
Salaam. I have heard one hadith that says only one sect out of 73 sects will enter heaven, and the other 72 sects will enter Jahannam. Could you please clarify this hadith?
This hadith is mutawatir, has been narrated by different chains, you know. Many scholars, they consider it as mutawatir. Who is this sect, you know? The best answer comes from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, ma ana alayhi liyum ashabi. The way that myself and the companion, they are today, okay? And again, we should thank our shuyukh, because they told us about this tradition book, you know, to see how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has companions they used to live. Okay, so here the best answer comes to that hadith from the hadith itself. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as we get used to this, you know, will not leave us in doubt, you know, or not knowing what. In the same hadith, he said, "Ma ana alayhi liyum ashabi." Whatever is my tradition and the tradition of my companion.
Salaam. I find myself going through periods of low iman, At such times, what can I do to bring my iman back up again?
We should, all of us, strengthen our knowledge in Allah. I keep nagging, you know, about it because I feel myself deficient, you know, in this. And I feel, I don't know if I'm right or wrong, you know, nowadays, just few of people, you know, or speakers, you know, speak about knowledge in Allah. Okay? Part of your knowledge should be in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is not aqidah, not fiqh, not this is to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In my view, the best way of knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to recite the Quran. Okay? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the hadith Qudsi, this is hadith, أنا جليس من ذكرني. Whoever recites Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to sit with him. Okay. I imagine, I cannot explain well, you know, but what I imagine when I sit with Allah, when I try to speak in the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaking with him, I think my knowledge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to increase. Okay. When my knowledge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase, my love to Allah is going to increase. My confidence in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to be increased, you know. And for sure your iman is going to be different style. If you want to add on it, you know, I keep speaking, you know. Let's have some privacy with Allah. What do I mean by this? Before Fajr, you know, Sahar time, before Fajr time, wake up, make wudu, and two rak'ahs, short rak'ahs, okay? Just privacy between you and Allah. We know the farad, we know how great is suhr prayer, fajr prayer, and you name it. Let's have this privacy. The one who try to knock the door of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by these ways, in my thought, I don't think Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to reject him and tell him get out. This is my thoughts about Allah.
The question says, very important question. When is suicide allowed in Islam? If you know 100% sure people are going to torture you and your children to death, can you kill yourself, your children, to save them from such a death, e.g. in the time of Dajjal when his army comes?
I think I answered this question in my talk. Okay, what did I say? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in many occasions of his seerah, when you ask the intellectual people, you know, about certain event, they say it's better to do this, to be better off, better powerful, have better economy or whatever. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam disregarded all those matters, all those analysis, all those assumptions that we have, okay? And he said, what did he say? I care only about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because all of those matters, they are in the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants this to happen, you know, to have my children tortured, you know, even if I intend to kill them, you know, they are going to be tortured, okay? No doubt about it, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants this. So the best way to deal with those very heavy and very critical, you know, positions that we may get exposed to them, that's Allah al-afiyah, is to go the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to. But to listen to this person and the other person and to have something which is illegal or is prohibited, you know, in Islam, no, I cannot say halal, okay? So again, to make the long story short, you know, for this question, you go by the instructions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam again put the quotation, harisun alaykum. He did not tell us to kill ourselves when the Dajjal come, okay? I would like to ask the asker, do you keep saying, Allahumma inna adulkan adam qabra, adulkan adam nar, adulkan fitnat mahi wa matu, adulkan fitnat al-Masih al-Dajjal? That's what the Prophet ﷺ instructed us to do. What does the Prophet ﷺ instructed us to do? He said, memorize the 10 verses of the beginning of Surah Al-Kahf. You are going to be protected from Dajjal. He said, whenever you hear about Dajjal, don't go and look at him. Don't be curious, you know, about it. No. I don't care. I'm going to run away, you know. I don't want to see the Dajjal. And the Prophet gave us all measurements that we need to protect us from this fitna. Some of us, we are going to be exposed to him. Then the Prophet instructed us what to do, okay? He's going to give us the choice between hellfire and paradise. He said, go to the hellfire of his, you know, because his hellfire is the paradise, okay? That's it. I don't care. I'm going to close my eyes and go. That was the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. That's what Abu Muslim al-Khawlani do. What did happen to Abu Muslim al-Khawlani? He's a great person, well-known one, you know. Compete with the companion, you know. He was not burned by the fire.
Sheikh, what are the benefits of being part of a group such as Chishti, Dawat Islami, etc.? Is it fundamental to do so? How far can I get without being bay'ah to Sheikh Peer?
The Prophet was instructed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to say, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ إِنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ إِلَيْكُمْ جُمْيَعَ. I am the messenger of Allah to all humankind. If the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is going to establish certain way of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or certain person, or certain something, I'm sorry to say, his religion is not going to be valid for all times and all people. That's why the tradition of the Prophet ﷺ was exactly the opposite. What do I mean by this? When he is ordered, commanded to give, to instruct people about certain obligation, he'll do it. But in the meanwhile, he'll tell them, don't ask me anything. Even the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would like to pray overnight strongly. When he observed that a lot of people pray behind him, he stopped doing it. You see what I'm trying to say? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is very broad, very open one, you know. He has all those matters that may be experienced by me or you or anyone else, okay? That's why you feel the Quran is the characters of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, like an ocean, you know. All those matters is going to be included in it. And the chest of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the characters of the Prophet are the same. They are going to include everything, okay, of those matters. I said yesterday that some of the companion, you know, whenever they see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for the first time, they don't have even the ability to quit joining him. You know, the other, they came for 1 hour and they returned back. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not criticize those or the others. Okay, and we should have the same look. You know. Here to say the best way to have peace, yes, this is the best way for certain section of us. The other section, perhaps the best way to have bay'ah. The third section is better to have nusuh, advice to give each of the other. The fourth one, to be in the community. Don't stay alone, okay? The fifth one, I cannot imagine, you know, because this may be against some text, you know, to be alone. I don't think this is a good idea, you know, because I feel it against them. So here, as you may see, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam set up different patterns, you know, of this matter, which tells me, firstly, this is not an obligation. Not something that should be done by everyone, like the prayer. Secondly, to contain in it, in this instruction, everyone. Okay. Really, I love Sufi a lot. Okay. Can I make everyone as such? No, I cannot. Sometimes I may not be able to make my son as such. Okay. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to consider him different religion, or different taste? Am I going to set a barrier between myself and my son? I'm sorry to tell you, no. All of these people, you know, they will say, this is kafir, this is kafir, this is kafir. when he's tested with his son, he will not say that his son is kafir. And there's something wrong here. Okay? So, if that one is not your son, he's a fellow of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that means you love yourself much more than the Prophet. You don't care about failures of the Prophet, you care about your son. And this is, if you are lover of the Prophet, doesn't make any sense. You are out. You failed in the test, okay? If you are real lover, you know. I'm speaking of my experience, you know, I may be wrong, okay? Yani when I started, I don't know if I want to say this one. Yani when I started my life, I feel that I love the Prophet. So I was going to be strong against anyone, against Mulid, or just come here, I'm good. Then I found out this is not the way the Prophet was. Okay. The Prophet wants acceptance of everyone. This one would like to do more. Okay, let him sit here. The other one doesn't like. These are not pillars of our Islam. These are not obligation. I never heard the Prophet ask one, you know, to say, look, listen, Ya Rasulullah, you are a Nur, you know. He did not ask anyone to say so. When they tried to praise the Prophet as the Salafi, they said, he did not say, don't praise me. No, they are wrong, those people. But he said, when you praise me, feel that I'm something different. I'm not like the others, you know, when they are praised. قُولُوا بِقَوْلِكُمْ وَلَا يَسْتَهْوِيَنَّكُمْ الشَّيْطَانِ I'm not that when you praise a president or praise a politician, I'm something else, okay? And here, as it wrong, you know, from that side, you know, when they understand it, don't praise, it's wrong from our side when we try to praise the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as something, a habit, you know, we got it. No. You should feel it. You should have the word by word, you know, come from your heart. You are praising the Prophet here. You are not just singing, you know, a song, you know, in front of someone, you know, to make him happy. No, you are praising the Prophet. Are you honest? Are you truthful with whatever you say? Here, so before accusing the other, let me accuse myself, you know, about this matter. Let me, if I am really love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, behave the same way. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to accept everyone. Yani you read in the hadith, this person is about to be killed, you know, and he said, La ilaha illallah. If you ask me, I'll tell you this person is liar, you know. He just said, La ilaha illallah, because he doesn't want to be killed. Yet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even though the one who killed that person was the most beloved person to him, he got really angry with him sallallahu alaihi wasallam. To the extent that person said, I did not become Muslim before that particular day. What does this mean? Yani that means the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to accept everyone. Even, you see this hadith, I think some of you have read this hadith. What is this hadith? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, while I'm in the pool, watering pool, some of the people of my nation, they will be introduced. And then they are going to be taken away. And I start shouting, oh Allah, this is my nation, my nation. He said, you don't know what they have done after you. The Prophet knows because he told us about this hadith. You see? He told us what's going to happen. So what does this mean for me? Yeah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam knows those people, they are wrongdoers. They have done whatever they have done, yet out of his hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he wants the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to come. He wants those people, you know. He don't care that they have done wrongly or whatever. He wants them to get, you know, to the happy life, you know, to the heaven or you name it. And you read in Bukhari, you know, you're surprised a lot, you know. This is, if it's not mentioned by the Prophet, perhaps I will not believe it, you know. But I have full belief of it because it's mentioned by the Prophet. Sayyidina Ibrahim, you know, in the hereafter, you'll meet with his father, who is mentioned in the Quran, regardless who is this person, okay? Even though we have been told by Allah that he make himself bari of him, you know, that he rejected him, free of him. Sayyidina Ibrahim made himself free of him. You see, on the hereafter, what we have been told by the Prophet, he is going to meet with this person, start blaming him, how come you did so or that or whatever. And that person is going to tell him, do whatever you want to do today, I'm going to obey. He will tell him, you see, he will tell him, listen, hold very well to me and I'm going to pass with you the Sirat. This is not my behavior, this is the behavior of one of the most noble persons, Sayyidina Ibrahim. He said, listen, hold still, hold to me, and I'm going to pass the Sirat with you. I ask myself, how come Sayyidina Ibrahim do this to that person? I answer myself, because he knows about the mercy of Allah much more than my knowledge. I'm too limited, I'm too down. Sayyidina Ibrahim is knowledgeable of the mercy of Allah, and he gave a try, you know, of this mercy, you know, to come, okay? So those among us who are a little bit selfish, you know, and they enjoy the way they want, you know, and they don't enjoy the others, you know, as if they are limit the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is against what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us in the Quran, وَرَحْمَةِ وَسِعَتْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. This is against the tradition of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he had the full acceptance. And I'm going to end it by this story, you know, this is not related exactly, but it's in the same meaning. Sayyidina Abdullah bin Umar bin Khattab, this is a famous companion, a young companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They said in his life he freed roughly 1,000 slaves. You see, the slave in those old days, you know, it's like a wealth, you know, it's a significant amount of money. He freed 1,000 slaves. How? Why did he free 1,000 slaves? He said, he always he look at his slaves, you know. See, the one who is good, you know, good recitation of Quran, or good prayer, or good this or that religious person, is going to free him right away. And those slaves, what they are going to do? They are going to stand in front of him, you know, Allahu Akbar. Try to pretend that they are very good, you know, and very humble to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, good worshiping of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Sayyidina Ibn Umar, right away, you are free, go, yalla. And they told him, Ibn Umar, listen, they deceive you. Those people, they deceive you. He said, whoever deceives us in the sake of Allah, we are going to be deceived by him. Or deceived by him. We are going to be deceived by him. So let's have it this way. Let's assume some of those people, they are in hellfire. Since they are, for us, looking like saying, Ashhadu an la ilallah, Ashhadu anna Muhammad, they pray and we are going to have full acceptance, full open chest for them, you know. They, you may have some of them deceiving us, you know. This is not our task. The Prophet ﷺ told that companion, he said, why you don't open his heart, you know, and see if he's right or wrong, you know, truthful or not truthful, you know, about it. And here we don't have, yani this door was closed by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We don't have the permission to open anyone's heart. We don't know what's inside the heart. And anyone who is Muslim, perform his prayer, whatever, this is not your authority to call him kafir. Okay? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam hadith, he said, whenever a believer is cursed, like he is killed. I like that action, you that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam got real angry about that, this companion, the most beloved companion, when he killed that person. He said, when we curse a believer, similar to kill him. And we should take the word of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Don't say this exaggeration or what. No, it's the most truthful. And this is the right expression, you know. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, this like killing him, I say, like killing him. Okay. When I call him kafir, I feel this is worse than cursing him. When I call him kafir, because I know the value of my belief. I hate anyone to say to call me Kafir, okay? Because I know the value of my belief. So how can I, you know, have this behavior, you know, toward the other, you know, against that, to call them Kafir? This is not my task. If I'm deceived, okay, I'm deceived like Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Umar was deceived.
Time is over.
I really should apologize, you know, because I speak something right, something wrong, something up, something down, you know. I forget myself, so you may excuse me.
You can't read it.
If everybody remains seated, we have to have some housekeeping announcements. And due to popular demand, a machine by Sidi Shazam before we close, and we have Misha. For the brothers, please don't hang around in the corridors upstairs. The sisters use